Hello, malty mango marmalades. And thank you to Danev for that malt mention, which can mean only one thing, malt mates. Yes, you have arrived here in the Manx Bothy for a ralfy review of a single malt Scotch whisky on this occasion. And this is ralfy review 656. This is Tomatin, 12-year-old Scotch single malt. Tomatin Distillery is a Highland distillery, a North Highland distillery, just a few miles south of Inverness. Now, you know, it's a big distillery. It's very large. In fact, its main purpose is the production of single malt whiskey for well-known blends like Antiquary. There you go. You might not have known that. And recently, such is the demand for single malt whiskies that they have made more of a feature and more of an effort and provided quite a large variety of their own official bottlings, which have been rebranded, reissued, re-released in various non- and age statement varieties. And you also get a peated version called Kubakan. There you go. Now you know. Age varieties? Well, the non-age statement ones are called Fire and Wood and Legacy and Decades. The Decades one I have reviewed and I really, really enjoyed it. It was a very nice and affordable range of different ages vatted into a single malt. Very nice indeed. But you get, in terms of age statement ranges, you get 8, 12, 14, 15, 18, 21 and 36 year old single malt versions. So there's really quite a lot of variety of Tomatins out there. And the reason this distillery can do this is because it's one of the top 10 single malt distilleries in Scotland in terms of capacity of production. There we are. But big question, malt mates, does it smell and taste nice? Right. Now, I'm reviewing this particular one. I must say, I'd probably prefer the 18-year-old because it's just had more time, and Tomatin, believe me, needs time to get where it needs to go. It's just that when you've got a big distillery, things aren't really kind of overly sensitively produced. You're really regulated by the volume of your production and the operational norms that, you know, dictate this. I know that wouldn't apply to Macallan. Well, maybe sometimes it does. But I'm finding this whiskey on initial contact a little bit rough, right? A bit rough. Full of flavour, but it's just a little bit rough, a little bit edgy, a little bit stingy and nippy on the nose and the palate too. That's why you're coming to this review, and it's not normal that I would take a 12-year-old single malt and have a glass already poured. But I poured this about 20 minutes ago because it really needs every damn minute it can get just to settle down and become a little more good-natured. Before I forget, this is bottled at 43%. Not that you've got a remote chance of reading that fact on the label, unless you use, cue the steampunker, a powerful magnifying glass. Really, the invisibility of the print on this label is shocking. I'll just catch the light, and I'm just getting the light here. 43%, there you go. Bourbon and sherry casks. And then it gives you loads of flavour notes. And on the box, it gives you some wonderfully sweet, enticing, disingenuous flannel about the purity and the loveliness and the softness of the water. This is a fruity whiskey. It's actually more Speyside by nature than it is Highland by nature. It has a medium sweet nose, fresh apples, figs, most definitely dried figs specifically, some sultana, a little bit of pear, a little bit of cola mint, not polo mints, cola and mint together, unusual combination, but that's really what kind of helps define its slightly aromatic herbal spice character. All in all, it's really quite a lovely nose. It's when you take your first sip, malt mates, that's when your smile turns to a bit of a frown. The arrival itself, hold me a minute. Take two. The arrival itself is quite intense, almost gummy confectionery, fruit, toffee, barley sugar, a little bit of brown sugar in the background, some vanilla, some mild muscovado, a little bit of milk chocolate in there too. A drop of water, you'll get the flavour. But I've added a lot more water because I just want to tone down the heat in this malt, which is actually unpleasant in the back of my throat. And you find this with quite hastily produced whiskey. It's just a little bit hot, not unpleasantly hot if you know how to tone the liquor down before drinking it. And this is part of the skills and the arts of Scotch single malt whiskey appreciation, is being able to read how you need to modify a whiskey before you enjoy it at its best. And the thing is, although it's a little bit hot, it really is part of the character of this malt. Initially, it comes across as unpleasant and a negative influence in the flavour. But latterly, given time, adding water, you're really getting a deliciously complex young single malt going on here, which is really, it reminds me in terms of character a little bit about like some recent Binromachs, which is a distillery not that far away. Note, single malt distilleries are clustered into neighbourhoods, and particularly in Speyside, where the biggest clusters of distilleries are, you will find that in certain areas you get themed characteristics amongst distilleries that are close to one another. Good example is Glenfarclas and Aberlour, which are plenty dry fruit and sook sherry. There you go. That's better. Fresh grapes. Nice, slightly spicy, sour herbal note. Angelica, wintergreen, mild mint, grapefruit, pears, lemon juice, apple, green apple, slightly underripe, sour green apple, banana, fig in the flavour as well. But the fig tends to be integrated with the vanilla and the brown sugar, or the brown, well, demerara note that you're getting in it. The form, given time, because this is a very different whiskey experience if you sip it raw straight after pouring it and don't leave it with a drop of water for 10-20 minutes, which is longer. I mean, this is breaks the rules, you see. I say a minute in the glass for every hour, for every year in the cask. This needs about 2 minutes in the glass for every year in the cask. But having said that, the end result works well. Importantly, that negative heat from a busy distillation, from a faster paced distillation, is toning down, it is mellowing, and it's mellowing completely in the right direction. Good, busy, slightly sweet arrival. It's turned sour and herbal in the development. The spices are coming back again as you move through that development. A little bit of, what is that? That's the green, there's a green tea, a bitter green Japanese tea. Mencha, hencha, something tea, sancha tea, green tea, that you get in powdered form and it's quite bitter. You're getting that bitter green Japanese tea or Chinese green tea in the latter part of the development into the finish, and a little bit of dry lemon juice. That's a bit of a contradiction. Some dry lemon juice, I'm going to stick with it, and vanilla in the finish. But the aftertaste still has a touch of heat about it. So, take note. This is quite a decent whiskey. I'm happy to recommend it, but you really got to handle it with care. You've got to prepare well with this one, or you may be disappointed. This is a theme, by the way, that I'm going to come back to in my next review, because it's only through experience that you learn these things. It's important for me to share my experience with you so that you can gain your experience more quickly and more thoroughly than I did, and thus make fewer mistakes. But I'm going to give this a malt mark now. Malty mark. Here we go. 85 out of 100. It's a malt mark. Now, malt mates, for the second part of this review, I'm going to draw your eye past these bottles, which are centre stage, to the shelf behind, where another glass of whiskey sits waiting patiently. Now already you're wondering, hey Ralphy, what's going on here? Well, when I poured this glass from that bottle, I poured this glass at the same time, except the whiskey went into this miniature bottle and I added something to it and let it sit for a week. And this stuff is called top shelf peat smoke. This is liquid peat smoke, and you can buy it from homebrew beer making supply accessory shops. Homebrew makers know all about this. They know all about yeast. If you have a beer maker in your whiskey club or in your circle of whiskey friends, malt mates, you have got a big advantage over those clubs and malt mate circles that don't. Brewers are a fantastic source of first-hand, hands-on experience in the production of fermented grain liquors, the use of different yeast types and how they affect, and the duration of fermentation and the temperature of fermentation. And also when they're making their beer, and if they want to make it a little bit peatier, they can use this concentrate. Now, when you know this, I can buy this on eBay, and I recommend you do. It's not that expensive. When you know it, it tastes quite clinical, antiseptic, peaty, but medicinal, and it tastes like, it smells like Lafroig in a bad mood. That's not very complimentary, is it? Yes, we've all been there. Lafroig's in a bad mood. We remember those nightmares. But what I've done is I've poured some of this whiskey into this marrying vessel, poured literally 5 drops of this peat smoke essence into the whiskey, and now I'm going to nose it and taste it for you and compare it to the standard proprietary bottling. That'll be interesting, won't it? You won't find this anywhere else, only here in the Manx Bothy. Immediately on the nose, far less fruity. In fact, it's barely fruity at all. It has a slight smokiness. That peat is very much in there, but it's sitting lighter than it does in Cubacan, which is the official peated version of Tomatin. This is more light, it's more subtle, it's a little bit more Ardmore in character on the nose. There is a little bit of vanilla oil, lemon oil, a little bit of overripe banana. There is something quite herbal and dry about it, and there's something which is slightly what we would call wersh or unsalted. It certainly is dominated by the phenolic note, which has kind of blanketed the standard smell profile, but it's not done so in an unpleasant way. You can see that it's dominating in the nose, but at the same time, there's still a complexity going on in there. Taste-wise, my goodness. I suspect I've used, by the way, 5 drops in 10 millilitres, you'd probably do fine. You'd notice it with 1 drop. So I probably added a few more, at least 2 more drops than I needed to do so, because this is coming through now as quite heavily peated. The peat is fairly simple, but it's well defined. There's nothing chemically about it. It's not TCP. It's blending in just fine. I would probably, in hindsight, give it an extra week to marry together, because the influence of this peat is really dominant. So there's a bit of a tussle going on in the glass in terms of the flavour profile between the existing single malt and the addition of a few drops of peat essence. But it's making for a very pleasant and interesting alternative to the standard glass. Nose is utterly different. There's a fruitiness coming back through, but it tends to be of a rich, intense sultana. More of a russet apple. Some dark coffee notes as well. The standard glass. Excuse me. Standard glass. After tasting the peated version, the standard glass version from the straight from the bottle comes across as much almost lighter fruit notes, because the palate's been so affected by the peated version. But I've put the two together now to get something of a middle distance, and this is where I'm going to conclude my review. It's a fascinating experiment. There's an awful lot to be learned from it. It doesn't cost that much, and of course what you're really wanting to know is what happens when you put peat essence into a heavily peated whiskey? We'll cover that shortly. I'm as curious as you are. That's better. In hindsight, retrospect, I would use half the volume that I used. When you smell this neat, you have no idea as to just how intense this peat smoke essence is. So even 1 or 2 drops into your specimen bottle will have a significant impact. But my concluding thoughts on this is that this actually tastes better than the Kubacan official peated version of Tomatin at around about 12 years. Very interesting indeed. But there we go. That's one reason why you come here, malt mates, so that you and I, we two together, and all the rest of us, can share a many, many married malt moment meditation. There you are. I'm Ralphie. I will see you soon. And do you know what, malt mates? I want you to have a good day. Go on, get out there and have a good day. A really good day. Don't buy a newspaper. Don't answer your telephone. Don't watch television. By the end of the day, you will have had a very good day. Bye-bye.